Department of Finance. It's a much awaited event in every finance undergraduate's life, as it gives the returns to the tremendous efforts put in by them in balancing both work and studies. So let me congratulate all the students present here today while thanking all our academic supervisors for their presence in this event and support all throughout. To officially inaugurate the event, we'll join with our alma mater.
Desati tu bos purumaya suratin siya suvandavi dukirana vidadena sada sandaki vidulakare udagina kalaniya sarasavi mata kalaniya sarasavi mata
Mentoring is a brain to pick, an ear to listen, and push in the right direction. He is always a guide and a mentor to us, and the guiding light to the Department of Finance. This humble invitation is for Professor Ruan Nabe Sekara, Head, Department of Finance, to deliver the welcome address.
Good morning to all of you. Dr. Narada Fernando, Dean, Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies, Chief Guest for today's event, Mr. Tushar Amarasuriya, Chief Executive Officer, Singer Finance, keynote speaker for today's event, Professor Ravi Isanayake, Head of Department of Marketing, and all the other heads who are joining virtually today, judges of pre-MT competition, industry evaluators, Senior Professor Chitra Ranjani, staff members of the Department of Finance, and my dear students. It is my honor and privilege to welcome you all to the Finance Award Ceremony 2021. We meet this morning to celebrate those who have successfully completed the internship program and the research dissertation. Ladies and gentlemen, the Department of Finance is celebrating its 10th anniversary this year. The department offers 4 degree programs, namely Bachelor of Business Management, Honors in Finance, Banking, Insurance, and Financial Engineering, catering to about 700 students. During these 10 years, the department has had many milestones. CFA recognition for its degree programs, obtaining A grade from University Grant Commission for its quality are just 2 milestones. Further, this year we are planning to obtain ISO certification for our degree programs. The success of the department is due to the qualified staff it has got. We currently have professors and PhD holders in our staff. So most of them have professional qualification as well. We believe that our students must gain firsthand exposure to working in the real world in addition to the technical skills they get from the degree. That is why we have included an internship component in the degree program, in which the students are supposed to get trained in reputed organizations. Further, we have realized that our students need research skills that improve their critical thinking and analytical skills through hands-on learning. Hence, we have included the research component in the syllabus. The students are supposed to carry out a research project under the supervision of a staff member. On behalf of the Department of Finance, I would like to extend a warm welcome to Dr. Narada Fernando, Dean, Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies, who is the chief guest today. We are indeed grateful for your gracious presence. I feel grateful to welcome Mr. Tushar Amarasurya, the keynote speaker, who is going to deliver the keynote address under the title, Overcoming the Career Challenge in the Next Normal. So it is a pleasure for me to welcome Dr. Ravi Dissanayake, the head of Department of Marketing. And at the same time, I am happy to welcome Dr. Nisansala Vijayakon, Dr. Madhurika Nanakkar, and Dr. Prabhashini Vijayavanta, who are going to be the judges of the 3 minutes competition that is happening today. I would also like to welcome the heads of other departments, Senior Professor Chitra Ranjini, all the staff members of the department, academics, and the students. With all enthusiasm, I welcome you once again to this momentous event. So finally, I would like to thank Mr. Asita Gunasekara and the team for organizing this event. A special thanks should go to Dr. Ruwani Fernando, who initiated the 3 minute competition, and Mr. Daminda Veerasinghe for organizing the 3 minute competition that is happening in this event. Finally, I congratulate all the awardees and I wish all the best for contestants taking part in 3MT competition. Thank you very much. Have a pleasant day.
He is the main driving force behind every event and activity of the Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies. We consider it as a great honor to welcome our chief guest for this event, Dr. Narada Fernando, Dean, Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies, to address the gathering. Sir, would you please oblige?
Very good morning to all of you. It is a pleasure to address you all in this finance award ceremony. Professor Ruwan Abesekara, Head Department of Finance, and our keynote speaker today, Mr. Tushan Amarasurya, CEO, Singer Finance, Lanka PLC. Professor Ravi Dissanayake, Head Department of Marketing Management. Professor Dilrukshi Abhivardhana, Head Department of Accountancy, and all the staff members, industry partners, and my dear students. Actually, we all are having a dream when we are entering to the university to complete our degree with all the requirements. So that maybe in terms of knowledge, in terms of skills, and hardly if we can develop positive attitudes. So when we are developing the study program in every degree program, So we have to follow with the requirement or the standard set by the University Grant Commission and the Quality Assurance and Accreditation Council. So that's why all the degree programs in Kalaniya University Management Faculty going with the levels requested by Quality Assurance and in line with Sri Lankan qualification framework. So where it is a mandatory requirement, research and internship. So in the classroom, all the students, they are going with the knowledge component, discussions, assignments, and presentations. At the same time, so they are exposing to their work environment within the final year. So that is the specialty and that is the beauty of each and every degree program offered by management faculty. So they are completing more than 600 hours, which requested by the Quality Assurance Accreditation. At the same time, most of the students, they are continuing with the places where they started their internship. So I must thankful to all the industry partners for crafting all these graduates, those who are coming from Kalaniya University and training them with the requirement expected by industry. And at the same time, I want to congratulate Department of Finance for this endeavor. Every year they are going with this internship certificate awarding or finance awarding ceremony and the selecting of best researcher. So that is one of the main qualification or requirement as a national university graduate. So with all that, hope that today's event, we can see a lot of activities with the students of the finance department. And I wish all the very best to the certificate awardees in today's event. And at the same time, I must thank head of the Department of Finance, as well as the organizing committee, especially Mr. Asita Gunasekara, for organizing this event. And wish you all the very best in this finance certificate award ceremony. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for joining and sharing your valuable thoughts with us. We have now reached one of the most important events of today's agenda. Accepting our humble invitation, we have with us today Chief Executive Officer, Singer Finance Lanka PLC, Mr. Tushan Amarasuriya, for today's event. Mr. Tushan Amarasuriya is a fellow member of the Chartered Institute of Management Accountants, an affiliate member of the Association of Chartered Certified Accountants, a certified global management accountant, a member of the Chartered Institute of Marketing, and holds an MBA with the University of Leicester, UK. Prior to joining Singer Finance, Mr. Amarasuriya held many responsible positions at Singer India Retail, Singer Sri Lanka PLC, and Cargill's Food City. He has over 16 years of managerial experience in retailing FMCG, retailing consumer goods, and in financing and leasing industry, and serves in honorary positions as the treasurer of Saukhyadana Movement and vice president of the Mercantile Cricket Association. We would like to cordially invite Mr. Tushan Amarasuriya to address the gathering.
Thank you very much for that introduction. Very good morning to you. Dr. Narada Fernando, Dean of the Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies, Dr. Ruwan Abhesekara, Head of the Department of Finance, Senior Professor Chitra Ranjani of the Department of Finance, Head of the Marketing Department, Professor Ravi Disanayake, all the academic staff, students and graduates of the Department of Finance of the University of Kalaniya. First of all, I would like to thank you for the invitation extended to me. I consider it as a great privilege to be here today and to be delivering this keynote address. As a person delivering a keynote address, my duty is to set the tone of today. So I shall do my best to do that in this August gathering. Before I move into the presentation, I would like to congratulate all the graduates who are being honored today. I understand that there are 130 plus young students who have completed their studies. Among them are students from banking, insurance, finance, and a relatively new subject to me, financial engineering. So congratulations to all of you. And I'm sure it's my wish as well as your teachers, your professors' wish to see one day some of you becoming CEOs, senior managers, perhaps entrepreneurs in your careers. That's the greatest honor that you can bestow upon them when you continue with your career in time ahead. So with that note, I would like to take you through a small presentation. I don't want it to be too long, but I do my best to keep it as interesting and as useful as possible. So when I was asked to speak on the theme of overcoming the career challenge in the next normal, I was thinking hard on what to speak, because this new normal, next normal is now the word that is spoken about in every corner of the country or every corner in the globe. Every one of us know that we need to wear the mask, we need to have our social distancing, we need to take the vaccine, and perhaps we need to work from home, be ready for that. Most of you would have lost the best time of your university life, the best final 2 years, and I'm sure you deeply regret for losing that time, although you were in the comfort of your homes. That is also something that we know. But having said that, just look at the schoolboys and schoolgirls who would have lost even a better time of their lives. Look at the sports people, the sports, the cricketers, the rugby players, the netball players of those schools who would never be able to represent their school ever again. I'm sure you'll be able to get some solace in thinking that the schoolboys and schoolgirls would have suffered more. So I was thinking hard, what am I to say? Can you or I predict the future standing here today? It's pretty hard, isn't it? One thing I can tell you is that, okay, we all saw that humankind has evolved over a period of many years, thousands of years, in gradual stages. Automation didn't happen overnight. I still remember the 386, the 486 RAM computers. I don't know. I don't think you all would have even heard about that. When I was even a teenager, I didn't know how to even open a computer. But my six-year-old daughter today knows how to use Microsoft Word. She knows how to on the computer. She knows how to off it. But I didn't know it until I left school, to be very frank. So that's how generations have evolved. And the evolution of technology has become so fast that it's very hard to predict what the world will be in 2030. Will be something that is very hard to predict, but to a certain extent, we can understand how it will be. So what I did was I did some research. Millions of pages on the web that you can go through, but what I thought was useful, I put it in a few slides. So I will take you through a few slides before I get into my thinking of what the next normal will be. So I went through the site of McKinsey, which is a research organization, and it's very interesting, just go through it. They have a prediction of how things will be for almost every industry. I selected a few only. They talk about the food industry. They talk about the apparel industry. So here is a slide on the future of insurance. Fast, easier claims. They say that people will not be willing to file insurance claims in the future, that it will be automated. It will be automated by something called telematics, artificial intelligence. A blend of artificial intelligence and telematics that will perhaps automate the claim, and your claim will sit in your bank account by the time you go home, fortunately, after a minor accident. If it's a serious accident, perhaps by the time you recover from your operation in the hospital. So yeah, so that's what they're saying. There's a lot of information there. Perhaps you can go through it. I'm not going to go through it in detail because we are time bound. So next slide is also a small few snippets that I took from a CEO of an insurance company. In that particular slide that I saw, he says he can't predict the future up to 2030. I myself genuinely thought that. But when I saw this, it endorsed my views. And so I thought, okay, I'm going to put it here. He says there will be less claims due to technology. Technology means these motor insurance, even perhaps marine insurance also will be the same because of technology. There will be less accidents, he says, because cars will brake automatically. At the moment, only a few cars are braking automatically, and one in the back gets hammered because of that. If all the cars don't brake automatically, the ones that don't are vulnerable. But in time to come, perhaps all the cars will automatically brake itself, and there will be less accidents. There will be less damage to human life. So, but he says, due to higher technology, that the claims will be higher. Now, if our cars get stuck, unlike the doses, you can't, push start the car, right? I am also mortally scared of what will happen if I get stuck in the middle of the road, because in the old age, I knew how to get it started, but now I don't. I will have to call my agent to come with a carrier and help me out. So that's the evolving state of technology. So if you go to the next slide, there is something from the parcel delivery industry or courier industry. They say that drones will disrupt the industry very soon. I think in the developed countries, it's already been tested. Deliveries have been done through drones. And go to the next slide, you can see a few ideas that they feel that will be reality. This is a hybrid. The first picture is a hybrid system. Yeah, actually, a vehicle goes near the house or the recipient's place of stay, and then the drone will take that particular parcel to him or her. The right side one, the parcel is sent from the delivery point straight away to the house. So, yeah, that shows though technology is available, it might be hybrid. It may not be possible for Pizza Hut to send the pizza from the restaurant to the house. They may have to use a intermediary or a van or something, and then from there send it because of various complexities that will be there. Because airspace may not be clear, depends on the country, all that, etc. So, yeah, that's a little bit from the industry relating to courier. If you go to the next slide, it's about the future of capability building. This is about the core subject I'm going to talk about today. It's capacity building, skills building, how best can you be future ready. So here there is a lot of literature. If you have time, please go through it about how you should adapt. I'm going to talk a little bit about it in the next slide. So they say the next 10 years will bring fundamental changes to our working world. And to adapt, employees in almost every role and industry will need to acquire new skills. The COVID-19 crisis has only accelerated these shifts. So we are talking about a new normal, about a next normal because of the pandemic. But remember, before that also, we were talking that these changes will happen. So remember, the pandemic has only accelerated. Let me go back to my experience at my own workplace. Though we were not 100% prepared, we were able to adapt quickly and work from home. We were able to get the resources that we needed to serve the customers and also for the customers to do their transactions from their home due to the digital capabilities that we had. Compared to a bank or a large institution, we had relatively less capabilities, but it was good enough for us to survive this period. So yeah, we were ready, but the pandemic really accelerated. Staff who has PCs are now given laptops. PCs are not ordered anymore, only only in the branches of a financial institution due to security concerns that we still don't give laptops, but even that will be overcome in time to come with the help of with the advent of software that will help us to manage those devices. So learning will become more personalized and purposeful. Earlier we used to go for a training program and listen to a common theme. Yes, those training programs will be there, but in the future it will be more focused on a set of people targeting their area of skills. There will be emphasis on big data. When you say big data, you don't have to think that it's a major thing. Software enables you to actually decrypt this major data into information. All the information that is required to learn that area is available on the web free. And you would be surprised to know, perhaps you already know, that the gentleman who advised Japan not to hold the Olympics, I think in 2020 or 2020, yeah, 2020, was a gentleman in Sri Lanka who did big data analysis. He analyzed the social footprints of the Japanese public. He was given access with approval by Google. I think Google hired, the Japanese government hired Google, Google hired him, and he studied the data and then referred to the Japanese government and said that your people don't want you to have it this year. So that's what data can do. And I mean, this data was lying in our systems all these times, all these years, but we have not made use of it. So next normal means let's use it, using technology and in an intelligent way. It's not rocket science in a way. So again, you say simulation instead of physical. Now we go physically to locations. Maybe even in the manufacturing industry, people go to see a plant. But now technology has made it possible for you to virtually have a virtual visit from your home. It's not through Zoom. It's not only through WhatsApp video call, but through higher technology, where there is a 3D visualization as if you are there. That kind of technology is available. You don't need to spend money and travel. I can tell you an example of a preliminary thing that we did. I have selected branches staying from Colombo through WhatsApp video. It doesn't need to have that kind of high-end technology to select the branch location by seeing it. So I didn't need to go to Ampar. From Colombo, I asked our regional manager to show us the location, the surrounding areas, and made a decision whether it's suitable or not. So you, before the pandemic, you never thought that. You either drove all the way to Ampara and stayed overnight and came back. And look at the time saving, look at the dangers that you avoid in our roads, especially in certain parts of the country where I travel extensively. It's not very easy, especially if you're driving yourself. So, yeah. And that's a little bit from the research available on the net. So I think it will give you idea of what the future will be. And next, I will come to what I think about. I'm going to skip this slide. So I strongly feel, am I going to ask all of you graduates who have qualified in insurance, banking, and finance, and finance engineering, financial engineering, am I going to tell you, you need to be experts in coding, you need to be experts in programming if you are to last your career? Will that work? I don't think so. Out of the 130 plus graduates, perhaps there are 10 or 5 members who are good in programming, in core programming. You have studied a different area of a different principle, right? So if I, as a keynote speaker, I, as an industry practitioner, come and tell you, if you are to survive the next normal, look here, so and so, you need to know IT, because it's all IT driven, right? All what we're talking, you're not going to go back to the Stone Age. We are going to go into a technological world. But if am I going to tell, as I said, your students that you need to learn this stuff, and if not, you are going to fail? I can't say that, right? It's not logical. Can you tell that to even a doctor or a lawyer? No. they need to, I will do my best to explain how you can survive the next normal. One thing we need to keep in our mind is that the next generation perhaps will be multi-qualified and multi-capable. As I said, my daughter, when she grows up, I don't know. Your daughters, your sons, when they grow up, perhaps they will be multi-skilled. So we have to survive our careers with them when we come to the tail end of our careers. That's from a career perspective. From something above that, if we are passionate about what we are doing, we also need to ensure that our companies get the best of us, not as a personal individual, but as a person who is passionate about the company. Until we retire, that we can give our best. We can adapt to the times that we work in. If not, there is going to be a culture mismatch, an age mismatch. Like perhaps our parents who perhaps are not internet savvy, who are not capable of doing digital transactions. We don't want to be that when we are 50 plus. So for that, we need to prepare. And for that, you need to revisit the basics. Revisit the basics means just finishing this degree and then going and doing a job itself will not work. You need to go back to your basics. I will tell you in the next slides what I mean about it. Then I say that you need to acquire cross-functional knowledge. It's very important. You can't be only a financial wizard. You can't be only an insurance guy. You can't only be a banker. As in that core area. Within that principle, you need to have a broader view. You can survive in that industry, but with a broader view. You have to be better at communicating and collaborating. Communication, lack of communication is one of the problems that we face in the industry. And I have some interesting slides at the end. You'll be shocked to hear that. So going to the next slide. Revisit the basics means you must be proficient in your English and any other language of relevance. Any other language of relevance is a choice. I'm not telling you all you need to learn Hindi or Mandarin, but that will be a kind of an added qualification. But English is important. It's very important. We see so many people struggling with their English skills in speech, in writing. Sometimes they can't collaborate and communicate because of that shortcoming. When they reach senior management, they can't sometimes hold their own in a board meeting. They can't diffuse sometimes heated situations because though they are very knowledgeable, they can't express. Without these skills, can we manage the next normal? These are basics, right? And these basics can be learned. It's not a rocket science. Perhaps a wider part of our fellow countrymen are poor in their language because of the mistake we did in the 1960s by making the country Sinhala only. I'm not scared to say that. It's a fatal mistake. If not, all of us would be, this particular line would not be there in this life. I have worked in India and you'll be amazed to see that how fluent they are in English. When I went there, I drove myself in 2009. There was no Google Maps. I didn't know Tamil. I was in the state of Tamil Nadu, but I was able to manage. I was able to find my way even in the middle of the night by asking people the way to where I live. I actually got lost one night in Chennai near the port. After a Sri Lankan individual's dinner party, I didn't know how to come back. I didn't know what to do. But fortunately, I was able to come because they were able to speak English. But perhaps that's a minor example. Even our people will be able to direct anyone here. But I'm talking of something more than that. They are very fluent in the English. When they do a presentation, a marketing presentation, they are very successful because of the gift of the gap. They say they are multilingual and they know English really well. So English is very important to all of you. Read to acquire knowledge, to improve language and also to relax. Reading is not only knowledge gathering. I'm sure students of this university, they do read. I have seen so many of them carrying novels. Even if you walk about, you will see them reading. I hear a smile behind me. So I'm sure you're a reader, right? So nice. Yeah, so there are readers. So reading, I'm sure this young lady spoke very good English. That means she reading is so important to improve a language. I have gone through stages of my life where I have had difficulties. I have continuously read for 1 to 2 weeks without doing anything else to overcome that emotional detachment that I had at that time. So reading will improve relaxation, improve your language skills, and above all, will improve your knowledge. If you are on Facebook, how will you get the knowledge? Because Facebook and Instagram, all the academia and also the retail or whatever you call, are also targeting you through that. Everything is now targeted through Facebook or any social platform. But our inclination is to look at the pictures, right? Not to learn truth. So you have to read newspapers. If it's digital form, it's good. But every now and then, go to the hard copy. It's essential. Then write frequently. Give the digital keyboard a rest. Because I have heard through a learned doctor, or many, not one, that writing, purely putting ink on paper itself, improves your creativity and improves your thinking skills immensely. So we have now given the pen and paper rest, and you're all typing, right? I mean, I misspell, sometimes I'm horrible in my spelling. If I had to write a letter, I had to go and look at the Google or Word, because I don't write anymore. That's one part, but your skills, your creativity will improve. So don't forget that. These are areas, basic areas I'm telling you to be prepared to face the new normal, the next normal. And time for health and recreation is very important. So if not, whatever we do, we will not be there in the next normal. Our lifespans will shorten. Health sector has improved, lifespans have expanded, yes, but then our lifestyles, the current lifestyles, will make it shorter. You'll be more sick people if you don't invest time in those areas. So it's very important that you keep these things in mind when you arm yourself to face the next normal. So, okay, acquire cross-functional knowledge. Professor Dishanayake knows that I am a great advocate of this. So you are in banking, finance, and insurance. I couldn't have the financial engineering part here. So yeah, if you are working in finance, if you don't have a appreciation of marketing, especially marketing, you are going to have problems in your job. I am here because I have deep understanding of marketing, as well as my core expertise is in finance. There you can see a hell of a lot of clashes in the private sector, in the working environment, when a person doesn't understand the other area of expertise, which is of importance. You don't need to have engineering knowledge in that job, but marketing is relevant to any industry. I don't think there is any industry which doesn't have relevance to marketing. Perhaps doctors and lawyers can't ethically advertise, but all others can. Even audit firms, but they have also found ways to advertise. They sponsor major events. I have seen audit firms advertising, sponsoring major sports events. Just that no message, only the brand name. So marketing has a lot of relevance. Don't acquire qualifications for the sake of acquiring. No point, because you have a higher qualification, you can add so much to your name. Very easy to add the number, add the designations. But do it from scratch and understand the subject. If you don't have time to qualify yourself, at least read the subject. That is very important. So I say law. Law is also complementary. Banking, if you look at it, more than marketing, perhaps depending on the area that you are in, if you are in core banking, law will be helpful. Insurance valuation techniques will be useful. With all this, I have highlighted that last column in red. That's nice to have. Possible. IT programming, IT security, IT management, it has come to a stage that I am now trying to learn a little bit of IT security, because as a CEO of the company, I need to understand whether my IT is on the correct path. I can't wait until the year end, or I can't wait until the experts come and do audit and tell me. I need to have some kind of understanding. I constantly fear because my knowledge is lacking in that area. So I have now downloaded some books from the internet before buying them, because freely available information is there. I'm trying to get understanding on the basics, because that is very important for the next normal. Understanding that. Now I am speaking as a CEO. Perhaps you undergraduates are now in your first job. But I started this keynote address saying that we want to see you being senior managers and perhaps CEOs one day. For you to equip yourself to come to that position, for you to equip yourself to face the next normal, you need to think in these lines. If you want to be good to great, you can be good. But if you want to be good to great, really fast track your career, you should think in those lines. I can't give, prescribe one way of doing things for you all, because your circumstances will be different. But with what I said, I'm sure you can pick and choose. So I'm now going to go to the last area. What I said was communication collaboration. And I'm going to take you perhaps through the most interesting two slides of this keynote address. This is a book that I read when I was in India. That book is still with me, but I couldn't find it in my book rack, but I somehow managed to download it again because of technology. This is about a crash of a Colombian airline called Avianca Flight 052 in January of 1990. So let's see how this plane crashed. Go to the next one. So the reason for the crash is loss of fuel, exhaustion of fuel. And the reason for the exhaustion of fuel is because these Colombian pilots was going to land in a American airport, either Los Angeles or I'm not sure of this particular which airport. You can get this on, you can do your research. They were critically short of fuel. That particular night, there were in three American airports, there were 90, 100 and 100 plus airlines lined up to land. Not like our airport, those airports are very busy. They were lined up to land. And when the pilot and the co-pilot, it's generally the co-pilot who communicates with the air traffic control, ATC. When the co-pilot informed American ATC, the air traffic controllers, that they are short of fuel, it was just another word for them. Because every airline that is about to land does not carry enough fuel. You can't land with a lot of fuel. You will perhaps burst the structure of the airline, and that itself may be a disaster. So when you land, there is always less fuel, enough fuel that will not damage the airline. That's the principle. So when you say, I'm short of fuel, the airline controllers think, okay, every plane is short of fuel before they land, right? So yeah, so I'll explain why a little further in the next slide. So inadequate traffic flow management by the Federal Aviation Administration, right? Lack of standardized understandable terminology for pilots. And these Colombian pilots speak Spanish, American ATC speaks English. So I'm now going to the book that I read and found out this. This is also available in the internet. This book is also downloadable from the internet. The PDF is there. And this refers to a Sri Lankan pilot as well. One of our pilots who is highly acclaimed in this particular chapter. They say investigators later summarized that the Avianca pilots must have assumed that ATC was jumping them to the head of the queue in front of the dozens of other planes circling Kennedy. So that there you go, the airport is Kennedy. In fact, they weren't. They were just being added to the end of the line. It was a crucial misunderstanding upon which the fate of the plane ultimately rests. But did the pilots raise the issue again, looking for clarification? No. Nor did they bring up the issue of fuel again for another 38 minutes. They were short of fuel. They were not telling with force that they need to land. So it's not like here in those countries, the next landing point, once you do a D route and come another 16 kilometers they had to wait. So, but what happened with Avianca was just so strange, so seemingly inexpressible, that it demanded a more complete explanation. That simply that Klotz was incompetent. Klotz is the second, was the pilot, and the captain was tired. Sorry, Klotz was the second in command, and the captain was someone else. So they, what they say is, this is more than them being tired. This is something more than that. There was something more profound, more structurally going on in that cockpit. What if there was something about the pilots being Colombian and that led to the crash? No American pilot would put up with that. What they said was, it's a cultural thing of not communicating properly. They, the co-pilot respects the pilot, so he is not forceful with the pilot. Both the pilot and the co-pilot is very respectful with the American air traffic controllers, so they are not telling forcefully that they need to land. This exact thing happens in companies. Just day before yesterday, I found out that we have budgeted for extra extra capacity in our servers. But one person in the IT department himself has decided that we don't need to do it now. We do it later. So by the time he does it, systems will get slower. This is life and death. That's not life and death. But no communication, no collaboration. Thinking is cockeyed. So may I have another 5 minutes? We'll go to the next. Another crash. This Korean Air Flight 801, August, crash in August 6, 1997. This was after that crash. Again, the National Transportation Safety Board says that poor communication between the flight crew as the probable cause for the air crash. This pilot was given an award a few weeks before this crash for safely landing an airline under duress. And 2-3 weeks after that, the plane crashes again due to miscommunication. I don't think any one of us here would have understood that planes are crashing due to these reasons, right? I read this in 2008-09. I used to use this as examples in my communications with my staff. But today I was more prepared. Thanks to the University of Kalania, I will now use this more because it's so relevant. Because perhaps it's in academia also, you would have come across these areas where communication leads to misunderstanding and leads to many other issues. So the final slide, this is very interesting. Typical accident involves 7 consecutive human errors. If one of the pilots does something wrong, that by itself is not a problem. So you can do one mistake, plane won't crash. Then one of them makes another error on top of that, which combined with the first error still does not amount to catastrophe. Still no problem. But then they make a third error on top of that. First error, no problem. Second error, no problem. Third error happens. And then another and another and another and another. That's a combination of 7 errors. That leads to disaster. They have found out that when they analyze the black boxes, when you read this book, you all can read it. The black box communications is there one by one. Colombian Airline flight communications one by one is there. You can understand how soft they were. Sometimes they say that you might have to use a word of filth and tell those air traffic controllers, look here, this word, we need to land. Then they will understand. So these 7 areas furthermore are really problems of knowledge or flying skill. These are not problems in flying skills. It's not that the pilot had to negotiate some critical technical maneuver or any that leads to failure. The kind of errors that cause plane crashes are invariably errors of teamwork and communication. One pilot knows something that important and somehow doesn't tell the other pilot. One pilot does something wrong and the other pilot doesn't catch the error. So this is from the airline history, something that we didn't know. These are true facts. This is available in this book. This is available in the web. So my point is, some of you are highly educated, very talented, highly skillful. You will be champions in your industry. But merely being a champion is not enough for you to succeed. You need to think deep. You need to communicate and collaborate. Basic things leads to disaster. It's the same in the industry. same in the private sector, same in the government sector. Definitely it is so. If you look at the flyover coming over here, it's easy going back, there is a bottleneck. There's some structural decision making that has gone wrong despite all of the effort, but that could have been rejected. So, I mean, you do such a nice flyover and that part, if that would have been taken into consideration, perhaps there would have been great relief, especially to the people in this area who goes to Colombo. So likewise, in your job, you will definitely realize if you don't collaborate and communicate, if you don't go back to these basics, you will not be armed to meet the next normal. Next normal, there is a lot of stuff. If you don't read, only if you acquire that knowledge, only that you will be prepared to have your organization prepared for the next normal. So I think I did my best to explain as simple as possible how you should arm yourself for the future. You don't need to be technological wizards. You can go back to your basics and still be a champion. So I'm sorry, I perhaps took a little bit extra of your time. And I once again like to sincerely congratulate all of your graduates today and the academic staff and the dean, everyone who has enabled them to get to that stage. I'm sure you all are doing a passionate job. It's not only a career, or it's not only a job to earn money. Or I know that you all are so passionate. Yes, you all are so into it. So you should ensure that you express your sincere gratitude to your teachers. And with that, I wish you all the very best for a great future. And also, before I end, I hope that you stay back in this country and take this country forward, because we cannot let a great civilization end with brain drain. So I sincerely hope to stay here. I don't want to move. And I sincerely hope that the next generation will take our country also to a better stage. With that, I wish you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for our inspiration as fresh graduates who are willing to start our career. Sir, would you please remain on stage as I cordially invite Dr. Narada Fernando, Dean, Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies, to present the token of our heartiest appreciation to Mr. Tushar Namrasuriya, Chief Executive Officer, Singer Finance Lanka PLC. Took a stride forward and built a platform to showcase the annual achievements and key aspects of the department, including all the real-time costs the government incurs when a student enters the university up until they graduate. We believe that these are facts that we all should be aware of as graduates. It's time to witness the unveiling of one unique outcome of our department: the annual report of the Department of Finance, University of Kalaniya. This invitation is for Professor Ruwan Abesekara, Head, Department of Finance, accompanied by the Editor-in-Chief, Ms. Jayani Chaturika, Lecturer, Department of Finance, to launch the annual report 2018-19. Thank you, sir and madam. Yes, the time we all have been waiting for, the time to acknowledge and recognize all the effort and hard work put in by our undergraduates in successfully completing their internship in finance. My dear colleagues, it's a time to witness the first session of the certificate awarding of internship in finance. Let me call the names of the students who are awarded with the certificates. A.D. Lenarachi, People's Bank. B.M.N.P.K. Balasuria, International Water Management Institute. B.M.S.P.S. Bandara, Jaisingha and Company. D.K.B.L. Bandara, H-Connect Private Limited. H.M.L.C.S. Bandara, Colombo Dockyard PLC. R.M.K. Bandara, Jaisingha and Company. ADT Dhananjaya, HMB Finance PLC. DMIU Dasanayaka, Bank of Ceylon. BASRD Dias, Diesel and Motor Engineering PLC. MRV De Silva, Agility Logistics Private Limited. DMCR Dasanayaka, Haley's Advantage Limited. EMDNB Ekanayaka, Guardian Fund Management Limited. EMTP Ekanayaka, People's Bank. LAR Fernando, Next Manufacturing Private Limited. WNS Fernando, Price Waterhouse Coopers. WGNS Gamage, EAM Maliban Textiles Private Limited. AWN Hansamali, Sri Lanka State Trading General Corporation. MJF Hasna, LM Associates. LHR Indica, People's Bank. JAKS Jayasingha, Brandix Apparel Solutions Limited. MLAW Kalpana, H-Connect Private Limited. LM Kasturiarachi, People's Bank. DGC Lakmali, Jayasingha and Company. MI Madurangi, Atlas Axilla Company Private Limited. HKS Madhushankar, Informate Private Limited. SJS Madhushan, People's Bank. DJ Meemanage, Lanka Sagusa Limited. BHP Mendis, Sunshine Tea Private Limited. HHN Mihirangi, People's Bank. KDDC Mihirani, Ceylon Leather Products PLC. KHISM Appuhami, Coconut Research Institute, Sri Lanka.
The internship course unit was not only evaluated by the lecturers of the department. It was a continuous process which included the compilation of weekly journals, submission of a record book, and finally, a viva voce. The students' knowledge and practical experience gained in different sectors related to finance and throughout their internship was examined and evaluated in depth by external evaluators from the industry. Therefore, we take this time to express our heartiest gratitude to our valuable resource persons. Mr. Asiri Vikramarachi, Deputy General Manager, Non-Motor Underwriting, Continental Insurance. Mr. Priyanga Madikasekara, Partner, Regional Human Resource Business, Sampath Bank PLC. Mr. Romal De Silva, Manager, Assurance, Ernst & Young. Ms. Gihani Silva, Manager, Group Finance, Joan Keels Holdings PLC. Mr. Pradeep Jayanta, Manager, Risk and Compliance, SC Securities Private Limited. Mr. Isuru Kanchana, Manager, Finance and Treasury, Pan Oceanic Bank. Ms. Ann Jans, Manager, Corporate Health Claims, Union Assurance PLC. Ms. Nilmini Kanchana, Assistant Manager, Treasury and Account Receivable, MJ International Private Limited. Mr. Chamra De Silva, Manager Underwriting, Head of Motor, Amana Takaful PLC. Mr. Atula Rajaguru, Manager, Internal Audit Department, People's Bank. Expertise knowledge from the industry is vital in building our career ladder. Therefore, I cordially invite our external evaluators to share their thoughts, ideas, and suggestions with us on the internship in finance, banking, and insurance of the Department of Finance. The session is now open for industry external evaluators.
Yeah. First of all, I would like to thank for inviting me for this ceremony and joining with you as an industry evaluator. Actually, I would like to say the internship program, which is a part of the degree program, is really important to gain the practical on-the-job training for a student. But as for my experiences, I have met some interns with only having theoretical background and not having proper idea on industrial requirements and development opportunities at the industry. Therefore, sometimes they switch their careers to another industry, or sometimes even not qualified to be getting permanent after the internship program. So as my overall suggestion, to avoid such scenarios during or after the internship program, the university can introduce some career guidance workshops and soft skills development programs in partnering with industry specialists, and also affiliation programs with professional institutes like Chartered Insurance Institute, because I am also from insurance industry. So to develop in the insurance industry, it's must to have the Chartered Insurance qualification. So I suggest to have affiliation programs with Chartered Insurance Institute, like financial institutes. So they can build up their careers by understanding and focus on their future career then. So I also have in experience with two of your graduates who worked under me. So they also have in multi-talent, and they also very good individuals with commitment towards their job. So I think that graduates which you develop from your university are very good talented individuals. So I wish you all the best for the award winners in today's event, and also other graduates who is stepping towards the successful career in the insurance and other financial industry. Thank you very much for inviting me there.
Okay, good morning all of you. First of all, I would like to thank for inviting me for this, giving me this opportunity and inviting me for this function. Am I audible? Yes, Ms. Shivani, audible. Okay. If I speak few words about this internship program, as I see, this is a really good opportunity to identify and meet industry requirements. So after a few years, all the students get after 4 years, all the students get a considerable period of time to work in the industry, and during that period, the students can practically apply theories they learn in their classroom, as well as they can deal with the people in the industry. And most importantly, as I see, when they're coming to the industry as graduates, they are molded to the industry requirements, and they are no longer strangers in the industry. So we should really appreciate this kind of training programs, especially in this university. I heard all the students have to submit weekly journals, and it shows like how dedicated and committed the students as well as lecturers. So I wish and I hope University of Caledonia can give us really good graduates to the industry, and we also give you our fullest support, and I wish you all the very best, and thank you very much.
So first of all, I would like to thank Department of Finance for giving us the opportunity to participate as internship by our external industry reviewers. So internship is the foundation for future employment. The students can apply their university learning in professional environments. That means usually known as theory into practice, while establishing critical network banking connections. The efforts put by their department to have an effective structured internship is commendable. The excellent initiative taken by the department on behalf of the betterment of students. Department always molding and crafting industry-ready graduates for different dimensions of financial market employment, while building the right attitude and skills to be employable. Nevertheless, department continuously supports students to attain internships as well. I like to mention that I personally know most of the finance department graduates are performing well in the industry. As a suggestion, I would like to mention that it's vital to move the record book towards the online platforms. Other suggestions has been covered by the other excellent reviewers. Finally, my congratulations goes to all the students and wish everyone all the very best. Thank you very much. Have a great day.
First of all, I would like to thank you for the academic staff in University of Kalaniya for giving me the opportunity to participate for this event and participate as an external evaluator in internship program. And also, first, I would like to say that it is a really good initiative taken by the university to organize an internship program for undergraduates. Because for undergraduate, they should not need only the theoretical background, but they need the experience from the industry sector also. So in my evaluation session, I have noticed that most of the students that they have covered up lots of areas, not only finance, but also the auditing, marketing, and all other areas in the industry sector. And I think it is a good exposure for them because after the graduation, as graduates, they are stepping to a very competitive industry sector, to the corporate world. And also, I would like to request from our fresh graduates, don't stop learning from here. You have to polish your learning, polish your what you have taken from the new industry trend, such as you have to take some experience and the learning from IT sector and also digital marketing, social media engagement, because they are becoming the demanding sectors now. So with your knowledge in finance, that those sectors will give you an added advantage in the corporate world. So I'm requesting from the fresh graduates, don't stop learning. Learn every day new thing. So it will enhance your value in the corporate world, and you will be competitive and you will be demanding by the corporate sectors. So again, I would like to wish you all the very best to all our fresh graduates, and also I would like to wish you all the very best for the finance department of University of Kalaniya.
And of awarding the certificates, acknowledging the successful completion of the internship in finance by our undergraduates. My dear colleagues, it's a time to witness the second session of the certificate awarding of internship in finance. Let me call the names of the students who are awarded this certificate. U.S. Munasingha, Access Engineering PLC. I.M. Mutubanda, Deloitte Consulting. W.M.G. Nimantika, Lanka Satasa Limited. P.T.S. Paranayapa, S.B. Rodrigo's and Company. R.W.G.T. Pereira, People's Bank. A.G.N. Humali, Lanka Mineral Sands Limited. A.A.D.D. Punsala, Bank of Ceylon. D.C. Rajapaksha, People's Bank. D.D.A.I.N. Ranasingha, Haley's Travels Private Limited. C.J. Randanigala, Deloitte Sri Lanka. W.K. Randika, Jayasingha and Company. W.A. Rasika, Screenline Private Limited. R.I.B.A.M.I. Ratnamalala, Sampat Bank PLC. R.M.T.M. Ratnayaka, Toyota Lanka Private Limited. H.A.S. Sajivani, People's Bank. M.A.G.I. Samarasekara, Lanka Satasa Limited. MAU Sandeepani Hale is Unisyst Engineering PLC. NHD Sanjula Hale is Adventist Projects and Engineering. KMIX Senaviratna Just Dynamics Private Limited. T. Sharjan Thanesalingam and Company. GMDT Silva SC Securities Private Limited. RWD Soisa Ceylon Bank. GGAS Sudarshani People's Bank. SL Sudhasingha Equity Knowledge Partners. MHBN Suravira Seva Logistics Lanka Private Limited. JAJ Taruka Musiti International Private Limited. JMK Viduranga Diesel and Motor Engineering PLC. GRPS Vaidyaratna People's Bank. WAIR Vijay Singha Secure Security Services Private Limited. MADPP Vijay Vardhana Pontera Brands Lanka Private Limited. Congratulations, dear batchmates. Now we have a special event lined up. I now cordially invite Mrs. Netmi Herath, Lecturer, Department of Finance, to conduct the further proceedings.
Good morning once again, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Netmi, the Master of Ceremonies for today's agenda. Welcome to the 3MT competition's finals. Research makes you think differently by engaging you in the creation of new knowledge. And at the Department of Finance, University of Kalania, we offer a platform to communicate new knowledge of our young budding researchers of the department in terms of a challenging competition. As of this year, our department, the Department of Finance, is exactly 10 years old. We learn and reflect to reach out our potential. So today, you are witnessing the newest addition to the DFIN Finance Award ceremony, the virtual 3-minute competition that we bring upon to you for the second consecutive time. The 3MT is an annual competition held in universities worldwide, and it was originated at the Queensland University in 2008. So if I give you a brief introduction to the 3MT competition, 3MT is open to research students and challenging participants. It challenges participants to voice their research in just 3 minutes. And it should be in an engaging form that can be understood by an intelligent audience with no background to the research area. This exercise develops participation, research and academic communication skills, and supports the development of research students' capacity to explain their work effectively. Dr. Ruwani Fernando, Senior Lecturer, Department of Finance, took the first step in initiating the 3MT competition in the Department of Finance. Now, let me introduce the judges of the today's competition. We have got 3 extremely resourceful persons. Firstly, Dr. Nisansala Vijayakumar, currently serving as a senior lecturer at the Department of Accountancy. She has earned her PhD from University of Waikato, New Zealand, and MBA from University of Colombo. And also, she has obtained the Bachelor of Business Management Special Degree in Accountancy from University of Kalani. Secondly, Dr. Madhurika Nanayakara, who's currently serving as a senior lecturer at the Department of Commerce and Financial Management. She has earned her PhD from the Australian National University and MBA from University of Colombo. Also, she's a fellow chartered accountant in addition to the Bachelor of Business Management Special Degree in Accountancy from University of Kalani. And next, we have Dr. Prabhashini Vijayavanta, currently serving as the senior lecturer at the Department of Human Resource Management. She has earned her PhD from Management and Science University, Malaysia, and MBA from University of Colombo. And she has also obtained her Bachelor's of Science in Human Resource Management from University of Sri Jayawardenepura. Also, she's an associate member of CIPM. Madam, we warmly welcome you all for today's competition. Now, I will briefly explain you about the rules of the game and the judging criteria before to set the scene. First, a single static PowerPoint slide is permitted. That means no slide transitions, animations, or movement of any kind. And the slide is to be presented from the beginning of the oration. Second, no additional electronic media is permitted. Third, no additional props such as costumes, musical instruments are permitted. And fourth, presentations should be limited for just 3 minutes maximum. And competitors who are exceeding 3 minutes will be disqualified from the competition. Fifth, presentations are to be spoken word. That means no poems, raps, or songs. Sixth, the presentations are to be communicated from the stage. Seven, the presentations are considered to have commenced when the presenter starts their presentation through any movement or a speech. And thus, the decision of the adjudicating panel will be the final. And when it comes to the judging criteria, under the first criteria, that is comprehension and content, the contestants will be assessed on the research question being addressed, impact of the research, its logical sequence, especially whether the presenter addresses to a non-specialist audience, and his or her time management. Under the second criteria, that is engagement, the contestants will be assessed on the oration, making the audience want to know more. It should be kind of interesting. For not being generalizing the research, the presenter's enthusiasm especially, and the presenter's ability to capture the audience's attention and his or her stage presence and the quality of the PowerPoint slide that is presented. So these are the rules and judging criteria which will serve the basis for selecting the winner for the day. And we have 7 finalists for the competition. Contestant number 1, Diluni Punsala. Contestant number 2, Migara Ratnayake. Contestant number 3, Hasini Mendis. Contestant number 4, Lakshan Bandara. Contestant number 5, Nawod Samaratunga. Contestant number 6, Sandali Sudhasingha. And finally, contestant number 7, Sandeepani Mutusingha. So all of these contestants are final year undergraduates of the Department of Finance. So without further ado, let me introduce the contestants' orations of 3MT of the Department of Finance. So the first contestant of the day, Diluni Punsala, her oration is on the impact of service quality on customer loyalty in Sri Lankan banking sector with the mediating role of customer satisfaction. Her work was supervised by Professor Ruwana Besekara.
During the first lockdown period of our country, I had to face a huge problem. Since there were lockdown restrictions, we couldn't physically go to the shops to purchase goods. So the one and only solution was to buy online. I am pretty sure you all have done a lot of online transactions during that period. Not only you, but I have also done a lot. However, there were some unauthorized transactions from my bank account during that period. Oh my God, I was so worried. How did it happen? Even though I am a loyal banking customer who constantly dealing with that bank for a long time. Then I immediately contacted my bank and inquired what had happened. They asked me to send an email to them and told me they would look that matter. However, until the end of the lockdown period, I didn't receive any reply email for my issue. I was so angry. Then I withdrew all my money and moved to another bank. I thought they are so careless and their computer system is unsecured. Because of this bad experience, I carried out my research under the topic of the impact of service quality on customer loyalty in Sri Lankan banking sector. When I went through some previous research, I found that they have used only the human factors and physical factors to measure the bank service quality despite the technological factors. Since my issue was related to the technical side, I thought I needed to develop this framework by adding technological factors. So in my research, I measured the service quality of banking sector and human, tangible and the technological factors. By distributing an online questionnaire, I collected data from 112 loyal banking customers in Sri Lanka. I analyzed whether they consider the trustworthiness and the friendliness of the bank employees, whether they consider the physical setting of the bank including parking facilities and interior designing, or they think the accuracy of the computerized system when they deal with the bank. In order to analyze them, I used a regression model. According to my findings, most of the loyal banking customers prioritize human factors and they need a friendly banking service provider. Other than that, they want to have a reliable and accurate banking system to transact with, and they pay less attention to the physical setting of the bank. Therefore, if a bank improves their friendly customer service with an accurate computerized system, they can gain more loyal customers and retain existing loyal customers just like me. Thank you so much.
That was interesting. And the second contestant of the day, Migaru Ratnayake. His origin is on impact of working capital management policy on market value addition, a comparative study of manufacturing and plantation firms in Sri Lanka. His study was supervised by senior professor Chitra Ranjan.
Let me take Toyota Lanka as an example. Toyota Lanka is the distributor of Toyota and Hino brands in Sri Lanka. Now you may be wondering how a car dealership can continue their business despite all the ban of vehicle imports. Toyota Lanka vehicle sales is just one revenue driver, and they are also generating the revenue through the services and spare parts sales. Is it possible to generate the same income through the services and spare parts sales? Yes. So how? If I ask a question now, would you go for a Toyota Lanka to do any auto repair or spare parts purchases? Most of them in here say no, we don't, because their prices are high. Yes, their prices are high because they are providing the genuine parts, not the fake panel or reconditioned products. Due to this vehicle restriction, now there is a tendency of vehicle owners to move for a genuine parts for the long winter of their vehicle. So now Toyota Lanka has opportunity to increase their revenue through the availability and supplyability of spare parts, because the service and spare parts revenue is depending on the inventories. But now the problem is prices. If they use the same inventory parameters, ordering parameters, stocking policies as previous, they cannot cluster the customer demand, because now the demand is more varied than previous situation. In this case, management can decide whether you are opening a new service station or outlet to meet the customer demand. But if the required resources is not with them, they cannot do it. It means they cannot generate more additional value for their business. If the company invests, because this is the decision of investing business funds on short-term and long-term assets. If the company invests their funds on short-term assets, they can maintain a better liquid portion, but they cannot make in the profit by investing them on an investment plan. Therefore, in order to continue their business with the existing, with the retaining existing customers and attracting new customers, company need to execute a better working capital management policy. In my thesis, I investigate how does working capital management policies impact on market value addition. I selected 15 manufacturing firms and 15 plantation firms and found that different firms are using different working capital management policies, and they are impact on the way they are impact on different way for the business value, firm value. If the Suzuki Motors implement the same working capital management policies implementing in Toyota Lanka, they cannot drive their business to the success, because their business environment, industry expectations are different. So therefore, Suzuki Motors need to investigate their business, study their business environment, industry, future expectations, and implement adequate working capital management policy to continue their operation smoothly by increasing the value. Not only the favorable economic condition, but also in the pandemic situation like this. Thank you.
Thank you for the presentation. And our next contestant number three, Hasini Mendis. Her oration is on dividend payout and firm performance evidence from listed entities in Colombo Stock Exchange. Her work was supervised by Mr. Ruan Vijay Singh.
Why does the company need to concern about their dividend policies? Let's take a simple example. Let's assume that there's a company A who's declaring dividend every year. This will provide the positive signals to the stock exchange and the investors were encouraged to buy shares, which increase in the bid for the stock prices. There's another company who pays less or no dividend because they might have other attractive investment opportunities which will lead to increase in the value of their shares. See, both these options ultimately increase in the company's share price. But when it's come to the theoretical background, a theory is like MM theory. This explains the entire opposite of what I just said. It indicates that dividend that the corporation pays do not affect the value of its shares. So, how does the investors actually behave towards the company's dividend policies? Well, a dividend policy actually conveys some kind of a valuable information to the investors. Like this, if the company raises their dividend, investors feel that company performances are so good and it's enough to pay, enough to support higher dividend payout. This leads to increase in the share price. What is happen if they cut their dividend? In that case, it concludes that company performances are not so good, it's poor, which leads to drop in the share price. However, if the company actually does badly, these movements might be permanent. Otherwise, it could be temporary. When it's come to the Sri Lanka, is it how they actually behave? Well, even theories, literatures were able to explain the corporate behavior of the dividend policies. Does those theories actually applicable for the Sri Lankan context? This is where my research will focus on the impact of dividend payout on firm performances in Sri Lanka. In order to achieve this objective, I have integrated market-based as well as a financial-based performance measurements to explain the impact. The study chosen a listed company which represent the 50% of market capitalization in CSC and use statistical regression model to examine the influence of dividend payout on firms' performances. The result that I found is yes, a firm's dividend payout does have significant influence on firm performances. The implication of my research is very clear. In Sri Lanka, investors were more concerned about the company's dividend policies. Therefore, management, policy decision makers need to pay their major attention on firms' policies on dividend because significantly it will influence the firm's financial and market performances. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up in line is the contestant number 4, Lakshan Bandara. His oration is on the impact between business firm characteristics and dividend distribution, evidence from Colombo Stock Exchange. His work was supervised by Mr. Shanika Pereira.
Let me ask a quick question. Who wants to become a billionaire? Let me help you. Or everyone here know the person in this picture? Yes, he is Shanika Pereira. How we get to know him? That's right. He is famous for making good financial decisions in share market. One of the main reasons for his success is better use of money and information than any of us. But if he can, why can't us? So how we do it? When we have excess money, what we normally do? Yes, we put those in our savings account. But what if there are more other ways to do it? One is share market. We can simply define share market as a more effective way of managing our savings with sharing with business companies. Similar to bank gives us interest for our savings in return, those other methods also give something us back. In share market, which is called dividend provided by the companies that we share our money with, which is a part of their profit. So not every company provides this because not every company earns profit every year. So the question is how we identify what company does. That's where I come in. The aim of my study is to identify how business characteristics impact on dividend decision of the company. Let me explain. Imagine your hometown supermarket, let's say Food City and Satosa. What do you think? Who earn more because of their size of the organization, availability of product and the customer service? You got the answer right. Fine, right? Just like that, my study is aimed to examine how firm size, ownership, profitability, availability of money impact on dividend decision of the company. For this purpose, I use 180 companies below 20 sectors listed under Colombo Stock Exchange over 5 years' time. Just like how we look for better facilities, years of trust, reputation, defaults, open and savings account in the bank, we need to collect some information regarding the companies on how they manage their business before to share our money with them. Based on my finding, I can strongly recommend out of 20 sectors, 8 sectors shows influence of firm size, ownership, availability of money, profitability, impact on dividend decision. Those sectors are material sector, capital goods sector, healthcare sector, utility sector, retailing sector, diversified finance sector, consumer service sector, and food and beverage sector. So my suggestion is better start looking for other ways to manage your financial if you want to become a billionaire one day. Then the next top news of the year will be on you, just like the man in the picture. Thank you.
Thank you for that interesting presentation. Next, we have contestant number 5, Navod Samaratunga. His oration is on stock market response on COVID-19 in Sri Lanka. His work was supervised by Mr. Daminda Veerasingha.
How have you been doing during the last year? Was it fruitful? Well, it was not a best of years I ever had. I suppose it must be the same for you too. Due to the simple reason, yet the complex situation of COVID-19 pandemic. Imagine as individuals, if I and you suffered the consequences of COVID, what if for business organizations, large communities and whole world at large? Believe me or not, still most of the countries and economies are struggling to find their way out, including Sri Lanka. However, I'm not here to talk about COVID-19 or how it spread all over the world. I believe the response from Colombo Stock Exchange to COVID-19 reflected from three main categories of indices, namely S&P SL20, ASPI and JIC Sector Index. To check the significance of the impact, I followed the event study methodology, which describes whether the specific event influences the changes of the stock prices and impacts on stock returns when there is a valid, efficient market hypothesis. I analyzed the three indices on three event periods. First, before 30 days period of 31st December 2019 until the first COVID patient found in Wuhan, China. Second, from 1st January 2020 to 11th May 2020, where the period of increased the COVID-19 in Sri Lanka. And third, after the 30 days period of 11th May, where the first lockdown period was lifted. Even though there was not a significant changes to CSE from the first event period, when the first Sri Lankan patient found, the CSE started to react the event by gradually generating negative returns. However, the negative returns expanded heavily within the third event period, where CSE further declined its returns by 20% approximately. I was clear and evident. The CSE was responded negatively to the COVID-19 outbreak in 2020, like it had influences our day-to-day living. Let's hope COVID-19 would not bring any more negatives to CSE and us in the future.
Well, again, an interesting presentation. Next, the sixth contestant of the day, Sandali Sudhasingha. Her oration is on the relationship between trades of domestic and foreign investors and stock returns. Her work was supervised by Ms. Netmihira.
Well, let me tell you a story. This is Pial and his favorite vegetable is carrot. So he has a habit of going to the market to buy carrots once a week. This week he saw the price of 1 kilogram has gone up. Next week, again, he went to the market to buy carrots and he saw the price has been drastically come down. He has been a little surprised and was very curious to know the reason for the price volatility. Well, I also had the same curiosity, but not about the carrot market, about the stock market. Yes, you hear me correct, about the stock market. So what is the stock market? Stock market is the place where you buy or sell shares of listed entities. Then what is the stock volatility? Stock volatility is the price fluctuation where the stock price is going up and going down in a very short period of time. Scholars like you and I have argued the prime suspect for this stock volatility is the foreign intervention in the stock market. Therefore, the main objective is to fill this vacuum and shed some light on the important issue of how domestic and foreign investors' buying and selling patterns are affected to stock returns. Basically, for my research, I have used all the 289 stocks listed in Columbus Stock Exchange, which covers the 11 periods starting from January 2009 to December 2019. Simply, I have examined two research issues. The first one, how the past stock returns affect the future buying and selling patterns. The second one, how the past buying and selling patterns affect the future stock returns. Did I make you confused? Let me explain. Nimal is the closest friend of Pial. Pial has seen how the Nimal has earned a higher return by selling his very own car. This influenced Pial to buy exactly the same car to earn a higher return. Accordingly, this is what I wanted to discover in terms of the stock returns. While investigating, I was able to identify two interrelated branches. The first one, both the domestic and foreign investors are strongly positively related to future returns, which means the investors tend to buy and tend to sell stock returns following higher stock returns. I'm repeating, the investors tend to buy and tend to sell stocks following a higher future returns. The next one, the sales of domestic investors leads to lower future returns, while the both selling and buying of foreign investors have no impact to the future returns. So what can you see in the stock market? Yes, you are right. The key party who's responsible in the stock volatility is the domestic investors. But we ever cannot forget the fact that the foreign investors are also do chasing towards the local market returns.
Well, the last contestant of the day, contestant number 7, Sandeepani Muthusingha. Her region is on international portfolio diversification and implication for investors, empirical study of South Asian emerging markets and developed stock markets. Her work also was supervised by Ms. Anit Mihira.
Have a good day, everyone. Before I start my presentation, I would like to ask you a question. Do you know about international portfolio diversification? I'm sure most of you are familiar. Investors are always trying to minimize their risk by diversifying their investment portfolios. Investing in different sectors reduces the company-specific and industry-specific risk, but still, the risk of an economy was not possible to diversify. If an investor could diversify more optimally by investing in different countries, then the investors do have opportunities to reduce economy-specific risk as well. In recent years, international investment is growing rapidly among private and institutional investors due to the benefit of global portfolio diversification. Do you know who is the Oracle of Omaha? The Oracle of Omaha is nicknamed for the Warren Buffett. He is the one of greatest investors. There are many markets we can do international portfolio diversification. I selected equity markets. Is there any science to direct equity market investors? No, there are no visible science exit which may direct investors for investment. My study has been tested. The linkages between stock markets of developed countries and emerging stock markets in South Asia. And I used economic models to identify integration of stock markets. And I used monthly stock return observation for the period February 2013 to January 2020. I found that there are long run relationship between within the South Asian emerging markets as well as within the developed country stock markets. Also, there are short run relationship between many South Asian equity markets, but there are no short run relationship between selected developed equity market except the France and Japan. France and Japan has short run relationship. If investors could invest in a market that are having inverse pattern, it may definitely maximizing the wealth of investors. So my study will direct investors to invest in inverse pattern stocks to utilize their wealth across the world in a better way through international portfolio diversification. Thank you.
Well, those are the seven very energetic orations of 3MT finals. So while our panel of judges are finalizing the 3MT context winner of the day, we will now see who took the most attention today from these seven amazing performers. So it's time to choose the best among them in your way. So 3MT People's Choice Award, voting will begin soon, where we humbly request you all to participate in this voting process on the People's Choice Award. So the poll will be open for 1 minute. So please cast your vote to your favorite presenter of the day. Now you can view the poll on your screen with the seven number of presenters. Just click on your vote and submit. Once again, I will repeat the voting numbers of the presenters. Number one, Dilumi Punsala. Number two, Migara Ratnayake. Number three, Hasini Mendis. Number four, Lakshan Bandara. Number five, Namud Samaratunga. Number six, Sandali Sudhasingha. And number seven, Sandeepani Mudhusingha. So the poll will be open for only 1 minute for your vote. Hurry up and make your favorite presenter the winner of the 3MT People's Choice. Now let me turn to the judges seeking an overall comment of the finalists. I cordially invite Dr. Nisansala Vijaykant to share your valuable thoughts with us representing the panel of judges of the 3MT competition. Over to you, madam.
Right. Thank you so much, Netmi. A very good morning, everyone. And it's a really great pleasure to be with you all in this lovely. First of all, I would like to congratulate to all seven finalists and to all other contestants of the 3-minute thesis competition organized by the Department of Finance, University of Kalania. So actually, after listening to all seven orations, I do believe every one of you who made their presentations is a winner today. Why I am saying so, though originally aimed at higher degree students, being undergraduates, you have proved and demonstrated equivalent skills by presenting your research in 3 minutes effectively and convincingly. So every single oration, as I can feel, every single oration was brilliant and was passionate, was enthusiastic, and was really engaging. I hope the audience would also agree with me. Most of you have conveyed your ideas using effective presentation techniques and made the audience want to learn more and know more about the piece of work you are doing. You ended up with the take-home message and left the audience with an understanding of what you are doing and also what is important of your research and what you hope to achieve. So by doing all these things, you have addressed all the aspects of judging criteria of 3MT. So actually, this all made our job difficult. I hope our two judges would also add. So selecting a winner among best contestants is really difficult and was difficult actually. So I would say, regardless of who win today, all seven contestants have done a tremendous job. We should best with the rest of your research journey and your career as undergraduates. And finally, I thank Department of Finance and also the organizers of this competition for inviting me to judge this great competition. And I do believe that you will continue with this great competition. So thank you very much to you, Netmi.
Thank you very much, madam, for your insightful comments. So to announce the runner-up of the 3MT competition, I kindly invite Dr. Prabhashini Vijayavanta to announce the 3MT competition first runners-up. Over to you, madam.
Thank you very much, Netmi. A very good morning to everyone. So first and foremost, I must express my gratitude to head of the Department of Finance, Professor Ruwan Abesekara, and the organizing committee of this esteemed virtual 3-minute thesis competition, especially including Dr. Ruwani Fernando and Mr. Daminda Veerasingha, for having me as a panel of judges today. Of course, I feel honored. And I must mention that it is a really organized, well-organized event. So moving on to the contestant, I do agree with what was mentioned by Dr. Nisansala Vijayakul. Of course, all of you gave us a very tough time judging. So after a tough competition and based on the two main criteria, we decided to award the runner-up award to Miss Dilumi Punsala Amarasingha, who studied on the impact of service quality on customer loyalty in the Sri Lankan banking sector. Thank you, and over to you, Netmi.
Very much, madam. Dilumi, my congratulations to you. And she's awarded with a certificate and a cash prize worth of rupees 5,000. Once again. So now it's time to announce the winner of the virtual 3MT competition finance award ceremony 2021. Who would take that glory? I'm inviting Dr. Madhurika Nanayakara to announce the winner and to make any comments if she wishes to do so.
Okay, thank you, Nitmi. So first of all, I would like to thank Professor Ruwan Abesekara, head of the Department of Finance, and the organizing committee members of the 3-minute thesis competition for inviting me for the second consecutive time as a member of the panel of judges. It's really a privilege for me to take a part of this glamorous event. I will not take much time to announce the winner today. I know that you all are so excited to know the winner. As Dr. Nisansala and Dr. Prabhashini very correctly mentioned, it was a very hard and tough decision for us to finalize the winner due to the high competition. We mainly considered how the contestant communicated their research study in a manner that a person from a non-finance background even could understand the study in a nutshell. So today's winner is a unanimous decision, and all three of us were very impressed with the way that the contestant forced us to listen what's next. Using a very common example, the contestant was able to convince a technical concept in a finance discipline to a wider audience. My colleague, Dr. Prabhashini, she is a person from non-finance background, but I'm pretty much sure that she has also got the full idea of the study of our winner today. Without waiting you any further, I will announce the winner of the 3-minute thesis competition 2021 of the Department of Finances, Ms. S.L. Sudhasingha.
Now it's my duty to announce the winner of the People's Choice Award of Virtual 3MT 2021 of Department of Finance. Out of these 7 competent finalists, according to your award, now I have the voting results of People's Choice Award with me. So let me announce the winner of the People's Choice Award 2021. Once again, it's Sandali Sudhasingha. Extend the felicitation to all the winners and for all the contestants for the day. It's been great engaged in the process, sharing the research to a wider audience. Also, I would like to give a heartfelt gratitude to our prominent panel of judges for the day, for their unbiased judgments and the support throughout this event. Well, with that, I'm about to sign off from my end, handing over the podium to continue with the finance awarding ceremony. Over to you, Vishmini.
Lined up next is the third session of awarding the certificates, acknowledging the successful completion of the internship in insurance by our undergraduates. My dear colleagues, it's a time to witness the third session of the certificate awarding of internship in insurance. Let me call the names of the students who are awarded with the certificates. W-A-N-U-K-W Arachi, Soflogic Life Insurance PLC. M-M-S-M Divi Thottavela, Sanasa General Insurance Company Limited. M-D-K Fernando, Allianz Life Insurance Lanka Limited. G-D-S-M Godavela, Soflogic Life Insurance PLC. MMHN Jawardana, Allianz Life Insurance Lanka Limited. KKOJ Karunaratna, HNB General Insurance Limited. RMPP Kumara, Soflogic Life Insurance PLC. MI Lakshani, Regional Development Bank. KPDD Madhushika, Fairfirst Insurance Limited. MCS Madhuanta, Cooperative Insurance Company Limited. ADD Madhushankar, Continental Insurance Company Limited. APPV Patirana, Soflogic Life Insurance PLC. MSR Pereira, Cooperative Insurance Company Limited. EDBS Punsara, Sri Lanka Insurance Corporation. RADN Rajapaksha, Fairfirst Insurance Limited. RLV Ranavira, Orient Insurance Limited. BKMDS Rodrigo, Sri Lanka Insurance Corporation. SKK Sachinta, Union Assurance PLC. UGNL Samarasingha, Soflogic Life Insurance PLC. PGN Samarasingha, HNB General Insurance Limited. WAD Sandamali, Selinco Life Insurance Limited. WAC Sanjeeva, Cooperative Insurance Company Limited. GAI Udayanga, People's Insurance PLC. GW Uduana, KPMG Sri Lanka. HBRIM Vanshapala, Continental Insurance Company Limited. MGSS Vijay City, Soflogic Life Insurance PLC. MMMP by Yushan, Soflogic Life Insurance PLC. Congratulations to all the batchmates. Our department is filled with undeniable talent. During our final year, we completed our internship as well as the dissertation. Further, all of us participated for the 9 Students Research Symposium 2020, organized by the Department of Finance which was an excellent platform to exhibit the talent of the young researchers. Among the multi-talented undergraduates, now it's time to recognize and award the best researchers of the department. It's time to witness unveiling of one unique outcome of our department, the abstract book of the 9 Students Research Symposium 2020 of the Department of Finance, University of Kalania. This invitation is for Dr. Ruoni Fernando, Senior Lecturer, Department of Finance, accompanied by the Editor-in-Chief, Ms. Uttara Disanayake, Lecturer, Department of Finance, to launch the abstract book of the 9 Students Research Symposium 2020.
Thank you, madam. Being the best out of the best was not indeed easy. Among 118 multi-talented graduates, the department has selected 13 best researchers for the year 2020. Yes, you all are truly amazing, as it's time to witness the best researchers. Now I cordially invite Dr. Chatura Lienage, Senior Lecturer, Department of Finance, to announce the names of the best researchers.
Right. A very good morning to all of you. So it's my task to announce the winners of the 9th Annual Research Symposium for the year 2020. Before talking about the winners, let me talk about a few words about the process and the importance of this dissertation. Now, when it comes to dissertation, we need to first ask, do we need to really need a dissertation? In a 4-year degree, you have been studying and learning a lot of knowledge, but have you disseminated that knowledge? Have you able to create a value addition to the society and to the industry? I think this is where the dissertation will come into the picture. So you've been given the privilege of getting this dissertation component to your degree, and you'll be able to get the knowledge and also to disseminate to the society at large. So I'm sure a lot of you have done professional qualifications, and you can see this component is not in these qualifications. It is unique for a degree. I'm not going to undermine the professional qualifications, but this is where you get the opportunity to disseminate your knowledge. So let me highlight some salient points of this process. So as you know, this is an 8-credit module, and you will be studying or working on this module for the entire year in your final. And before that, you have been studied research methodology to get the background to this research. And this is mainly evaluated by 2 components, one for the main output of 60%, and then another 40% for your presentations. And even these presentations consist with 2 components. One is the progress review session and also the final viva. So you have been evaluated by many components, like identifying the problem, research objectives, data collection and analysis, literature reviews, supporting evidence on your future research, final outcome of your study, organizing your study, and meeting the deadlines. So with all these evaluations, you have been able to become the best dissertations. So now I would like to highlight the main dissertation awards of the 9th Annual Symposium. The first best dissertation award goes to RMTM Ratnayake. The topic is Impact of Working Capital Management Policy on Market Value Addition, the Comparative Study of Manufacturing and Plantation Firms in Sri Lanka. This is supervised by Senior Professor R.P.C. Ranjini. The next award goes to K.D.S. De Silva under the topic of Factors Affecting for the Customer Intention to Use Green Banking Product in Sri Lanka, supervised by Professor Susima Veligamage. The third best award goes to I.M. Muthubanda. The topic is impact of service quality on customer satisfaction with special reference to mobile telecommunication industry in Sri Lanka. Supervised by Professor Ruwan Abesekara. The next award goes to D. Sharujan. And his topic is relationship between financial crisis and capital structures, evidence from Colombo Stock Exchange. Supervised by Dr. Narada Fernando. The next goes to Viduranga, JMK Viduranga. And his topic is impact of environmental, social, and governance performance on firms' value. Evidence from the listed entities in Colombo Stock Exchange. And this dissertation is supervised by Dr. Ruwani Fernando. Next award goes to L.M. Kasturiarachchi. The topic is the impact of sustainability reporting and ownership concentration towards the company performance and analysis of Sri Lankan listed companies. Supervised by Mr. Ruwan Vijayasinghe. The next award goes to Pereira, DMRT Pereira, and the topic is impact of electronic banking on bank financial performance, evidence from commercial banks in Sri Lanka. His dissertation is supervised by Mrs. Dananji Basnaika. The next award goes to RWDS Soisa, and the topic is the effect of financial innovation and on licensed commercial banks performance in Sri Lanka. The dissertation is supervised by Mrs. Danushka Piyananda. The next winner is J.A.K.S. Jayasinghe. The topic is impact of exchange rate volatility on Sri Lankan bilateral demand of imports. His dissertation is supervised by Mr. Daminda Veerasinghe. Next winner, P.T.S. Paranayapa. The topic is the impact of government debt on economic growth in Sri Lanka. And this dissertation is supervised by Mr. Shanaka Pereira. The next winner is B.M.S.P.S. Bandara. The topic is study of impact on working capital management practices on profitability. A comprehensive comparative study between listed capital goods and material sector companies in Sri Lanka. And this is supervised by Mr. Asita Gunasekara. And the next winner is S.L. Sudhasinghe. The topic is the relationship between traders of domestic and foreign investors and stock returns. And this dissertation is supervised by Mrs. Netmi Herath. And the final winner is APPV Patirana. And the topic is impact of internal factors toward financial performance of life insurance companies in Sri Lanka. And this dissertation is supervised by Mr. Ruwan Buddhika. So I'll take the opportunity to congratulate all the winners for today's session and also giving the thanks to all the supervisors who spend their valuable time to make these winners a success. And finally, I would like to conclude these remarks by asking a humble request for all these winners and the dissertation producers for this symposium, that is to publish all their papers. Because through publishing, you disseminate your knowledge to the industry and the society at large. And also, it'll help to give the credit for your supervisors as well. And definitely it'll add on to your CV. So with that, I would like to conclude my remarks and hand over to the computer to do the thank you.
Thank you, sir. Lined up next is the fourth session of awarding certificates, acknowledging the successful completion of the internship in banking by our undergraduates. My dear colleagues, it's the time to witness the fourth session of the certificate awarding of internship in banking. Let me call the names of the students who are awarded with the certificates. AMTSB Abesingha, Regional Development Bank. AMKB Athapattu, Hatton National Bank PLC. FH Dankumbura, Hatton National Bank PLC. KDS Disilva, People's Bank. TDN Dilshan, Bank of Ceylon. WADS Dilshan, People's Bank. WAS Erandi, ADA Digital Singapore Private Limited. GMNT Gajasingha, Regional Development Bank. DACA Gunasekara, Good Hope Asia Holdings Limited. HHKKV Hera, Regional Development Bank. MYGJAC Kapila Ratna, People's Bank. TM Kumara, Hatton National Bank PLC. AC Madhushani, Hatton National Bank PLC. MNM Madhusingha, Sampad Bank PLC. PAS Piris, People's Bank. DMTR Pereira, Regional Development Bank. EUK Pereira, People's Bank. WAD Prambodhi, Bank of Ceylon. RBBS Rajaguru, Regional Development Bank. RGIP Ramandala, Dialogue Finance PLC. RDAD Samarasingha, People's Bank. LNPM Samarathunga, NDB Bank PLC. WN Sankalpani, Bank of Ceylon. DBP Srimali, Bank of Ceylon. KVM Sudhima, People's Bank. DM Sumanathilaka, Hatton National Bank PLC. KGI Tarangani, Hatton National Bank PLC. GAC Udari, People's Bank. WIB Veerakuttige, People's Bank. WRLS Vijayaratna, Bank of Ceylon. Congratulations to all the batchmates.
We have now reached one of the most awaited moments of the day, presenting the award for Best Intern 2021. It is definitely not an easy task to select one out of an extremely talented pool of individuals. So to explain the vigorous procedure, the criteria of selection, and to declare the winner, I call upon Mr. Asita Gunasekara, Lecturer and Internship Coordinator for 2020, to do the honors.
Yes, Head Department of Finance, Professor Kuan Abesekara, keynote speaker of the event, Mr. Tushar Namasurya, CEO Singer Finance, PNC. Dear lecturers and dear students and all the participants. So first of all, let me give a brief introduction to the internship program of the Department of Finance. So there are 61 students who have completed internship in finance, and we have 30 students who have completed internship in banking, and we have 27 students who have completed internship in insurance. So altogether, we have 118 students completed internship program in the Department of Finance. And I need to mention this, when coordinating the program, actually we faced few challenges due to the COVID-19 pandemic. We had opportunities as well as challenges. So some organizations gave many opportunities to internship, but some other organizations was not taken interns as the in their organizations. So we would be able to capitalize the opportunities, and we could be able to overcome challenges by enabling 118 students to complete the internship. And when it comes to evaluation criteria, we mainly evaluated the record book, and we received the feedback from the industry supervisors, and Viva presentation performance and professional development, academic performance, continuous assessment in terms of weekly journals, and compliance with the guidelines. We use these evaluation criteria. And evaluators was the academic supervisors of the Department of Finance and external industry evaluators. And we took industry supervisor feedback. So those are the evaluation related facts we have to mention in terms of internship in the Department of Finance. And we have nominations for the best interns. So we have three nominations for the best intern. Shashika Madhushankar, Sandali Sudhasingha, and Madhushi Silva. Out of these three nominations, we have selected a best intern. It was very challenging. We have selected the best intern. It was a very challenging task because all of the students were very competent. And in the evaluation program, we awarded them marks. So best intern of the event, of today's internship award ceremony is BM 2015-347, Sandali Sudhasingha.
Our warmest congratulations to Sandali Sudhasingha. To award the gold medal for the best intern, I now cordially invite our keynote speaker for the day, Mr. Tushan Amrasurya, Chief Executive Officer, Singer Finance, Lanka PLC, accompanied by Mr. Asita Gunasekara, Lecturer and Internship Coordinator, to award the gold medal. Thank you, sir. We once again congratulate Sandali Sudhasingha. I'm sure you behind the achievement there are many stories. Stories of hard work, commitment, and dedication. The stage is now open to you, the best intern, to share her experience.
Thank you, Vishwini. And again, very good morning to all of you. So first of all, I would like to thank my department, the Department of Finance, for introducing this course module, the internship in finance, because this is the only course unit or course module that we are getting a chance to experience the corporate sector or to explore the corporate world. So I'm truly grateful for that. And also I would like to thank our Dean of the Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies, Dr. Narada Fernando, and our department head, Professor Ruan Nabesekara, and all the senior professors, and all the lecturers for being with us for this past 4 years. And especially, I would like to thank our internship coordinator, Ms. Asita Gunasekara, and my academic supervisors, Mrs. Netmi Herath and Mr. Shanaka Pereira, for always being with us, especially when we were really struggling to complete our internship training requirements. So again, thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. And also, most importantly, I would like to thank my industry supervisor, Mrs. Ramala Edirisingha, Assistant Director, Investment Research and Financial Crime Compliance Equity Knowledge Partners. I'm truly grateful for her because I still can remember when I was at Equity and working at my table, she always come to me and ask me, Sandali, whether you can complete all your aspects of the internship training requirements. So that kind of a support, that kind of assistance was there for me at Equity. And if I talked about my experience, internship experience, actually, I still can remember the very first day I went to the Equity. That is not for the internship. Actually, I went to Equity when we were doing our CFA research challenge. I went there for a training. I have seen
how the different is the company when compared to the other companies. It was the work environment is totally different and the culture is different. So I really wanted to experience it. And going to equity and working at the hour is one of my biggest dream ever since I got into this finance field. So I'm truly grateful for that. So if I share some experience about my internship, actually I had to work with many different nations and many different cultures. Like I worked with Indian teams, Beijing team, UK teams, and also sometimes I had to work with Portugal teams as well. And sometimes I appointed to many projects and I was the only Sri Lankan there. So it was a truly amazing experience, I would say. And but sometimes I might find myself hard to balance both the academic and both the work life. But what I used to do is I write all the tasks on a paper and I post it on my laptop so I can see what are the tasks to be completed within a day or within a week or within a month. So that's what I used to do. So I'm not exaggerating my achievements, but I'm truly honored and truly happy to have this achievement. So thank you every individual. And I'm truly blessed to have a very support system in my life. So I'm truly blessed and truly thankful for everybody who have supported me. Thank you so much.
And we wish you all the best for a bright career and a future ahead. Today we witnessed only the tip of an iceberg. What's underneath the iceberg is but hold it up high. Throughout the course of preparation, there were times of joy, times of disappointment, times full of energy and times of sacrifice. There was a lot of hard work that was put in by our beloved lecturers, supporting staff, and all our friends behind the scene. It's time to appreciate the effort and contribution of these unsung heroes. I would like to cordially invite Mr. Asita Gunasekara, lecturer and internship coordinator, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Honorable chief guest of the event, Dr. Narada Fernando, Dean, Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies, respected keynote speaker of the event, Mr. Tushan Amarasurya, CEO, Singer Finance PLC, Head Department of Finance, Professor Ruan Labesekara, all the heads of Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies, senior academics, the most valued invited guests, dear students, ladies and gentlemen. I take pleasure in delivering the vote of thanks of this event. At the outset, it is my privilege to propose vote of thanks to chief guest of the event, Dr. Narada Fernando, Dean, Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies. Dear sir, your presence in this event is encouraging us. Thank you, sir. And your guidance is always appreciated and it leads us towards the success. Next, I take opportunity to extend my gratitude to the keynote speaker, Mr. Tushan Amarasurya, CEO, Singer Finance PLC. I hope your words encourage our students to reach the zenith of their career ladder by overcoming the challenges they face in the next normal. Thank you, Mr. Tushan Amarasurya, for encouragement provided for our students. Then I would like to thank Professor Ruan Labesekara, Head Department of Finance, for continuous support and guidance provided to make this event a success. Thank you very much, sir. I thank all the head of the Department of Faculty of Commerce and Management Studies who were presented physically and has joined online. Thank you, sir and madam. Your presence is an honor for us. Next, I express my heartfelt gratitude to all the lecturers of the Department of Finance for their support provided in numerous aspects to make internship program success until this event. And I take this opportunity to thank industry evaluators for partnering us in making this internship program a success, sharing their expertise with us in the evaluation panels. Further, I'm extremely grateful to the panel of judges of 3MP competition for adding great value to the event. Thank you, madams. Your contribution is much appreciated. Moreover, I'm thankful to Mr. Daminda Veerasinghe for his support as the coordinator of dissertations 2020 to this event. Mr. Daminda Veerasinghe, thank you very much for your kind help. I should thank Mr. Jayanith Adhutika the editor-in-chief of the annual report, and Ms. Uttara Disanayake, editor-in-chief of the abstract book, for support for making this event a complete and successful event. Next, my thanks goes to all the students and non-academic staff members who actively contributed for this event. Thank you very much for your support. Finally, I would like to thank all the parties who has contributed this event in many ways. Thank you all. Stay safe.
Thank you, sir. We have now reached the end of Finance Interns Awarding Ceremony 2021. To mark the conclusion of the event, please rise for the national anthem.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your valuable presence. Have a nice day.